Anybody have a testimony they'd like to share tonight? What you've learned from the Word of God lately? Anybody? Yes, Barb. Yeah. Praise the Lord. Amen. Let's head right there direction. Lord's good. Anybody else? Pam. Give us the abbreviated version. Praise the Lord.
She's been in it for, I believe, 35 days. I just went to see her last week. And thank God she's doing all her programs. She ain't getting, you know, breaking rules or getting kicked out or anything. And I believe, like, the Lord's really, really going to use her. She's getting out in 4 months instead of 6 months.
Good. Praise the Lord. Amen. Let's keep her in prayer. That's right. Amen. Anita. Praise God. Hallelujah. Got to have Jamie Lano on speed dial. Let's clear that thing. Anybody else? All right. We're looking at going beyond the mere study of the Word of God and getting it right into truth and getting deep into it. Last week we looked at a biblical model for imparting relational truth. I just want to mention one thing. We didn't quite finish last week. We'll finish that tonight and start the next session as well. But I want to emphasize what Justin Martyr said in AD 130, and that is the cycle, the Christian faith revolving around a continuing cycle of believing, belonging, and behaving. We believe the Word of God. We give our lives to Christ, and then He puts us into the family of God, right? So we belong then one to another. So we believe, we belong, and then we behave according to the Scripture. It's a cycle. And then we bring others. We share the gospel with others. They believe, and then they're put into the family of God, right? And then it's not just a thing of knowing the truth, right? We talked about that. It's not testing them just to see if they know it, but rather if we are living it, right? It's living it. Because you can have a dead faith. Faith without works is dead. Faith, basically, faith without living what you say you believe is a worthless belief, worthless faith. You know, they're talking about know the truth. okay? And that's the one thing, knowing the truth. The second thing is be the truth, and I think that's where we stop. So take your Bibles and turn to 2 Corinthians and also 2 Peter and also Romans 8. We're going to look at some scripture verses right in a row here. 2 Corinthians chapter 3. So we need to not just know the truth, but we need to be the truth. I've got a couple videos, but that's on the next session, Dwayne. Let me finish this one first. Be the truth. So simply knowing what we believe, 2 Corinthians 3:18, and why we believe it is not of itself sufficient. The truth that we believe must also become the very core of who we are. Correct? So buying into the Christian faith involves being a living representative of the truth. So are you a living representative of the truth, or do you just say you are? See, that's the difference. Are you being that? So what is being a representation of the truth? Anybody? What is being, pardon me? Okay. Anybody else? Being a living representative. Is it allowing the truth of God to penetrate us so intimately that it transforms our lives? Should there not be a life transformation? Should you not see that a person has changed? If it's really has taken a hold and taken effect, if it's really something that you're believing, something you're really getting a hold of, should there not be a change? Absolutely, there should be. Look at 2 Corinthians 3:18. Someone read that, because I'm not there yet. Okay, so we are being transformed into the same image. Do you know you could actually take that and you can gauge your own spiritual growth? Can't you? Are you different today than you were last year at this time? So what is the purpose of Christ's Spirit? What's the purpose of the truth? Pardon me? Okay. The purpose of his truth. True, let's go truth. The purpose of his truth coming into our lives is for us to become Christ-like. That's the purpose of it. Nailed it on the head. That's the purpose. So we become Christ-like. In what? Everything? In everything. Okay. Okay, so can you look back over the last week? If you can remember the last week. Was there an instance when you weren't Christ-like? So how do you feel about that? You say, well, I'm just human. Okay, ask for forgiveness. Okay, good. Because can't we just say, oh, that's, we can shrug it off, can't we? Okay, so when we receive the Holy Spirit of truth, Peter says we share in his divine nature, 2 Peter 1:4. And we'll read that. We share in his divine nature, 2 Peter 1:4. By which have been given to us exceedingly great and precious promises, that through these you may be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. I think it's safe to say that God's DNA, so to speak, when we get saved, is implanted in us, and a process of transformation begins then as we become conformed to the image of His Son. God's DNA implanted into us. It's no longer I that liveth, but Christ that lives in me. Let's go to Romans 8, 29. We're talking about being the truth. Romans 8, 29. For whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Now there are many believers who have a knowledge of God's truth and may even know why they believe it. But for some reason they fail to understand how that truth is relevant to their lives. Have you ever heard anybody say God's word is no longer relevant? Pardon me?
Yes, but they weren't believers.
Okay, they weren't believers. Okay. Believe it or not, there are some believers who have trouble with that. Don't ask me why, but they do. Okay, so the power of that truth then obviously is not appropriated to their lives, or they wouldn't say that. Right? So with that in mind, as we proceed in this teaching, we're going to discover step by step what we believe. We're going to start tonight. Why we believe it. What we believe and why we believe it. We're going to uncover the relevant and the transforming nature of each one of these truths. There's 12 of them. And when it is applied to specific needs of our lives. And that application, applying God's word to our lives, leads to our brand new nature continually, Colossians 3:10, being renewed as we learn more and more about Christ who created this new nature within us. Shouldn't we learn more and more about Christ? You know, too often, I've been saved 15, 20, 25, 30 years. What more do I need to know? Okay, you haven't even begun to scratch the surface. There's a lot to learn. Okay, so when we know the truth and we become a representative of that truth, a representation of it, we are not only beginning to embrace a biblical worldview, but we are also in position then, and here's a key thing, because this is where the church has lacked for a long time, effectively passing it on to others. Not just passing it on, effectively passing it on. When I ran track back in the day, don't ask me to run track now. Lord have mercy. I should, though. I had blood work done. I need to run track. Anyways, I talked to the doctor yesterday. Anyways, that's another story. I ran either the second or the third leg on the relay team, you know, depending on whatever. So you pass a baton, right? So there is an effective way to pass a baton, and there is an ineffective way. You've watched the Olympics. You've seen some guys just not pass it right. Although, man, they practice and practice and practice and practice. Okay. Did they know how to run the race? They knew how to run it. They even knew how to pass it, but they did not effectively pass it on. How many as parents and teachers or grandparents want to effectively pass on the truth? I don't want to drop the truth. I don't want to drop the baton. I don't want to drop the ball. I want to effectively pass it on to you. And I want you to effectively pass it on to those who are in your circle, or wherever that circle may be, effectively passing it on. So there's a saying that says, we teach what we know, we impart who we are. We teach what we know, we impart what we really are. You get that? That's important. Because we tend to say we know a lot. We can give all kinds of information. But man, what really matters is what? Who you are. Who are you? Okay? So, know the truth, be the truth, and thirdly, real quick, live the truth. Let's go to 1 John chapter 3. John's first epistle, the first book he wrote, chapter 3. So knowing the truth and being a representation of the truth naturally leads to living it, right? Knowing it correctly, being a representation of it, has to lead to living it. No way, other way. So let's look at 1 John 3, verses 18 and 19. My little children, let us not love in word or in tongue, but in deed and in truth. So many people say, oh, I know they live this way, this way, this way, but they're saved. My little children, let us not love in word or in tongue, but in deed and in truth. And by this we know that we are of the truth and shall assure our hearts before who? Before Christ. We want to assure our hearts before our fellow man. That doesn't make any difference. Make sure your heart is assured before Christ. Right? That's who counts. Because we assure ourselves of one another just mainly by our mouth. If our heart condemns us, God is greater than our heart and knows all things. Is truth to be lived? Yes, it is. When it is lived, does it become an example to others? Okay. Does that mean we must live perfect lives? Can we? Okay, we can't. When we understand that we can't live a perfect life, that sure takes a lot of pressure off, doesn't it? Okay. Have you shown actions to a family member or friends that were not a perfect role model of Christ's likeness? Anybody else? Okay. All of us? Okay. All right. All of us? Okay. Now comes a tough question. This is why we don't like to raise our hand and say, answer that. Because we always know it's another question. Okay. When you realized your offense, what did you do? You don't have to answer. I want you to think about it. What did you do? Now, after you've thought about it, what... And not speaking for yourselves, but what do people? Let's give us two reactions to that. Some will make an excuse for what they did. Is that Christ's likeness? Okay. Is that living the truth? Okay. Is that being a representation of the truth? Okay. Okay. So that's one side. What's another one? Somebody else. Apologize? Ask for forgiveness? Okay. So we have, is that Christ-likeness? Okay. All right. Is that living the faith? Okay. That's what we need to do. So those are basically two options, right? Okay. Go ahead. Somebody's got a third option. Okay. So that brings up another issue then. If you apologize, ask for forgiveness, and that person does not give that, now you've got another... Forget that person that didn't give it. Now what are you supposed to do? Should you forgive them for not forgiving you? Sure. It's over with, right? Because as soon as you start holding, well, that person didn't forgive me, now who are you? You're just as bad as the person that didn't forgive you. So that's a very good point. Okay. So forgiveness, that's a whole other subject. But there is a right way to respond. There's always a right way to respond. There's always a biblical way to respond. God's word being relevant today, God's word being lived out in your family. And that's the key thing. What good is it if you win the world and lose your own soul? What good is it if you're so involved in ministry you lose your family? Well, I shouldn't be involved in ministry. Yeah, you're supposed to be involved in ministry, but let's live the word of God. Let's live it. Okay, so we can mess up. right? We can mess up and not be a perfect role model of Christ's likeness. But however, we can turn that around when we're not that role model by allowing the Holy Spirit to conform us to the image of Christ. Right? Allow the Holy Spirit to do that. It's not an automatic thing. We have to allow Him to do that. We don't need to go around and fail on purpose, but those around us, it's not a crime for somebody to see you fail. Right? Am I right? We all try to be the perfect person because, man, what will people think of me? It's okay if you fail. It's okay because all of us do. Pardon me? Yeah, but they've already failed by not doing anything. Okay. What people need to see, there's two things people need to see. The world really needs to see this. The world needs to see people humbly seeking forgiveness and people forgiving. That's what the world needs to see. Because a lot of people think, oh, you just think you're perfect. You know, I am far from perfect, but I am saved because I seek, I think Lee said earlier, forgiveness. You forgive. You forgive. And I ask for forgiveness. Okay. So, the Spirit of truth through His Word is there to make us realize what is wrong in our lives. And it straightens us out and it teaches us to do what is right. 2 Timothy 3:16 tells us that. So being a living reflection of the truth in a fallen world means what? It means that, number one, I'm going to mess up. Okay, I'm going to mess up. And when I realize that I messed up, I need to make it what? I need to make it right biblically. Okay, now, what's hard about that? Okay. Admitting you messed up, can that be a problem? Okay. What causes that problem? Pride. Okay. Pride. Okay. So, I can admit that I messed up, but what would stop me from asking for forgiveness? Well, maybe because of the pride thing again, right? So pride's a killer. So as we uncover these 12 truths, it's already 5 to 8, these 12 truths of faith, we're going to discover what we believe, why we believe it, how they are relevant to our life, and how they transform us. I'm not interested in external transformation. I'm interested in internal transformation. Aren't you? Internal transformation. And then how we can live the truth out before other people, before those we work with, before our family members, so it's imparted to those we love. So as they take root in us, we're going to be reflecting. We talked about Jesus Christ is the what? The way, the truth, and the life, right? He is the way. He's a path that I must follow. He is truth. He's the only one that has truth. And if I want truth, I got to be in Christ. And he is life. If I want life, it only comes from Christ. So He is it. And so as these things take root in us, we're going to reflect Christ's way, Christ's truth, and Christ's life. It's a biblical worldview. So let's look at the first one tonight, and that is this. The truth is, as Dwayne runs to the computer, the truth is God exists. Number one. The first truth. God exists. Who is God? Okay, now, have you heard anyone ask, who am I really? Have you heard anybody ask, where did we come from? You heard that? Why do we exist? Is God out there somewhere? These are questions that we've heard people ask, okay? These questions are going to become more popular. Now, our little home on whatever street you live on seems so insignificant and small on this planet called Earth, doesn't it? You really think about it? Then this planet called Earth suspended out there in the universe. Think about that. And your little street? Pardon me? Well, yeah, right. So think about space for a moment. You and I can't even begin to imagine the scope of the universe or comprehend its depth or its size or its vastness, right? You can't begin to do that. So why does anything exist? Now, we're going to look at a video in just about a minute. We measure the expanse of the universe by a light year, right? That's how we measure, by light years. Okay. A light year is a distance traveled in 365 days. Light travels at the speed of 186,282 miles per second. In a year, that distance multiplied out and rounded off increases almost 6 trillion miles. Okay. Now that's tough to grasp. Okay. I can't even repeat what I just said. But to make it somewhat easier, it takes a sunbeam just over 8 minutes to travel 93 miles from the sun to here. That's fast. Right? That's fast. A little over 8 minutes. Takes me that long to climb out of bed. Scientists say matter is spread over a space at least 93 billion light years across. That's huge. Our galaxy, which is the Milky Way, is roughly 100,000 light years in diameter. And there are probably more than 100 billion galaxies in the observable universe. We are finite beings, and we can't imagine such distances, but I'm going to tell you, they are there, right? We have proven that. They are there. But what comes to our mind is the question, how was this vast space formed, and why? Let's look at it. We got that video clip? Okay, go ahead and look at that video clip. I don't know how long. It's about a minute and a half or something.
This is the Earth, okay? That is just you're taking off from the Earth from Southern California, and we're gonna rise up a little bit here, okay? We're gonna pull away from it. We're gonna pull higher. Now this is at about 10 kilometers. Like if you climb Mount Everest, this is what you'd see. You'd see the curvature of the Earth from that distance. Now we're gonna climb up even higher. This is at 100 kilometers. And you're a fourth of the way to the space station now. This is what you'd see. If you get to this level, you're considered an astronaut. Just, if you ever get there. Okay, now we're going 100,000 kilometers. 100,000 kilometers from the Earth. You're a fourth of the way to the moon. That's what the Earth would look like. Now we're going to pull away to 1,000,000 kilometers. At 1,000,000 kilometers, there's the moon. Okay, there's the moon. You can barely see the Earth. You're at 1,000,000 kilometers now. You're past the moon, and now we're going to go to 100 million kilometers. 100 million kilometers, you're still not to the sun. The sun's 93 million miles away, but now we're going to go to 10 trillion kilometers. There's the sun. Okay. You just passed the sun, now you would see all of the planets at 10 trillion kilometers. And now we're at 10 to the 15th power. That means 10 with 15 zeros. I don't know what that number is. 15 zeros, and the sun's just like a bright dot amidst other stars. And now we're going to 10 light years away. At 10 light years away, come on, let's go. Zoom, there you go. 10 light years away. Now you just see the sun with like 11 other stars that are kind of its neighbors. You know, that's our sun. And now we're going to go 1,000 light years away. At 1,000 light years away, you wouldn't even see our sun anymore. These are just a bunch of stars close to it in this cluster inside the Milky Way. Now we're going to zoom out even further, and that's the Milky Way we live in. See that cluster of stars? Those are about 100,000 stars that are closest to our sun. You can't see our sun anymore at this point. Now this is our Milky Way galaxy, and forget about the Earth. Okay, there's our Milky Way galaxy that we live in. And we're just buried in there somewhere. And we're going to pull out even further, and you'll see that our galaxy is actually, it's a big galaxy, and all those other things you're seeing now are galaxies. And we're going to pull away 10 million light years now. His next scene is 10 million light years. Those are all galaxies you see amidst our Milky Way, several hundred galaxies. Now we're going to go 100 million light years away. This is the last one. We're going to zoom out to 100 million light years. Those are all clusters of galaxies. Galaxies and clusters of galaxies. You won't even see our Milky Way galaxy anymore amidst that. We don't have telescopes that go beyond that little sphere there.
Amazing or what? That is amazing. Just taking a look at the Milky Way galaxy, and it made me hungry for a Snickers bar. But anyways, you see, and hey, that's amazing. How can you not believe in a God? Because there was even form to that, isn't there? Look, there's form to that. Okay, so time, the vastness of space, and the number of galaxies are for the most part mysteries to us, right? Yeah. Did it all happen by chance? Where did it all come from? Can we find mysteries on our own planet? And looking at nature, if you don't believe me, go pull up a rock. You know, I've done this with Royal Rangers before. Take a 6-inch small rope, you know, like kite string, and just toss it in the ground, on the grass, and then get a magnifying glass, and look at nature from one end to the other. It's amazing what is in 6 inches on the grass, what you find. So we find mysteries, and I'm going to look at nature for a moment. Let's go to Romans chapter 1. Verses 19 and 20. Dwayne, we probably won't have time for that other clip on an ant, but we might. We'll see. Romans 1, 19 and 20. Because what may be known of God is manifest in them, for God has shown it to them. For since the creation of the world, His invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even His eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. We can look at nature and we are without excuse. God does exist. Look at nature. I want to look at a specific ant. How long is this? About 2 minutes? Huh? Play it? Okay. All right, we're going to play it. You know how hard it is to be overruled by an ant? I mean, an ant is more popular than me. Okay, well, I've got the microphone, the ant doesn't. Anyways, of course, the guy who can play the ant has the power to my mic. Let me give an overview of this, first of all. We're going to look at the grass cutter ant. And these ants have developed a complex social structure called a colony. We're familiar with ant colonies. One colony can have hundreds of thousands of ants, and it requires sophisticated communication. You thought your marriage required sophisticated communication. Okay. And it requires a lot of coordination to gather enough food to feed that colony. And each of these ants is a specialized member of the team, just like you are. You're a specialized member of the body of Christ. Isn't that cool? So you have the scout ant. We're not going to look at the scout ant. But the scout ant, he is sent out for food. And he goes out and he finds this succulent leaf, if a leaf can be succulent. And then he scurries back to the colony, and he leaves a scent trail all the way back. And he communicates with the other ants. And then you have this foraging ant, who then follows that trail back to the food source. And then comes the cutter ant, who uses a song to communicate to the discovery of high-quality leaves, okay, that need to be harvested. And other ants hear this song, which is made by their legs, and it causes a vibration, and they feel this vibration quite a ways away. I forget how far. And they follow this vibration to the leaf, and together they cut it away from its stalk and carry it back to the ant mound. Okay, an ant can carry or can support 100 times their own weight, and these cutter ants will carry plants up to 1,000 feet. That's 3 football fields long. Man, can you imagine carrying 100 times your own weight that far to get the food to the colony? And these creatures, they're just a wonderful mystery, right? A wonderful mystery. Let's look at this mystery.
Sometimes animals take parts of the plant that the plant doesn't mean to be eaten. The leaves, for instance. These leafcutter ants luxuriate in a never-ending supply of leaves. Don't eat the leaves they cut. They take them back to other members of the colony, who grind them into a mulch for growing fungus. Then the ants eat the fungus. It's a cultivated crop needing constant supplies of greenery.
Science education, how about that? All right. So, I mean, isn't that amazing? That's just amazing how that happened. And that's just one example of, man, how much out there that God has put in place. Now, you know, as wonderful a mystery as that is, there is even a greater mystery, and that's your ability. Have you put stuff on the screen to read so far? Okay. It's your ability to read what Dwayne has put on that screen. Matter of fact, thank Dwayne for finding these things for me. And I appreciate it, Dwayne. It's your ability to read that stuff and to watch that and comprehend it. As much of a mystery as it is, those ants are in space. Marvel at what I just, you know, told you about these ants, what we saw about those ants, and in the video we saw earlier, because inside your skull is a 3-pound wonderment that God has given. And it's called the brain, okay? Your eyes blink. You follow words on a page. You follow the motion of the ants across the screen. The words are just letters put together. They're symbols with specific meaning. String together what? A thought as you read it in a book. Which you can do what with that thought? Understand it? Comprehend it? Okay. Your heart pumps. At least everybody here, your heart's pumping, right? You inhale and you exhale. Your body digests food and it processes food, and you don't even have to tell it to do it. It just does it, right? Okay. These are involuntary muscle movements that are controlled by that miracle organ between your ears. Your ability to walk, your ability to run, or used to be able to run, sit, sleep, touch, see, hear, smell, taste, feel, every type of emotion is being processed right now through over 100 billion nerve cells called neurons. Neurons. Okay. 100 billion nerve cells. Should actually have somebody up here teaching those what you're talking about. Mark? These neurons are like the gates and wires in a computer, but much more complex. Medical science has made significant advances in understanding how the brain works, but most of it still remains a mystery. And for example, in a digital computer, information is processed by a small set of registers that operate at speeds of billions of cycles per second. The brain uses its neurons to process more information, but at speeds of only around 100 cycles per second. So how does a brain function so much more effectively than even the most complex computer? Because of a bang? I don't think so. God exists. And God created you. And He created me. Your brain is the most complex biological structure known today. And it didn't come into being by some explosion out in that one video we saw. Lord have mercy. If you believe that, we need to sit down and talk about your faith, because it is absolutely huge. If you believe that. Yet, and we'll close here real quick. How did it come to be? How did the brain, how did you come to be? Where did you and your brain, the tiny ant, the Milky Way galaxy, and all those galaxies that we saw in the universe, where did they come from? God. That's the only answer. God. Why is there something in existence instead of nothing in existence? Okay. Got the right answer. What or who brought everything into being? I got an idea that Lee's going to say, God. Okay. And for what purpose? There we go. What purpose? For His glory. For His glory. And we're going to, it's already 8:15, so we're going to stop here. But we're going to really dig into this, because we need to know. We need to know. And not just to say, yeah, that's what I believe. I need to know why I believe it. And I need to know, how is that relevant to my life? And how can I effectively pass that on to others? There's a book that we got, Dick and I, and some other men went to a conference back in February. I actually gave the book to Mike. But how the two most famous atheists have given their lives to Christ. They realize there is a God. You haven't seen that on the news because the news don't want you to see that. The last thing the media wants you to see is an atheist saying, there's a God. But what about a TV preacher saying, all of a sudden come out saying there is no God? He would make front page. He would make front page. But you turn the thing around and no, we got to cover that up. I tell you what, the media is covering up the truth. But we're going to uncover it. Let's stand tonight. So we're going to look next week. We're going to begin. Actually, the one song they sang tonight has this in it. You know, some, what was that song? Where are you? Or some say, forget the words now. Some say you're not here or whatever, in a distance. An impersonal God. We're going to look at that starting next week, and then we'll get into some other things as well. Amen. Well, it's good to see everybody here tonight. Remember the service Friday night. It's going to be a great service. You're not going to want to miss it. It's going to be a special communion service. If nothing else, come for that. It's going to be good. And appreciate Mark putting us together, and those that are part of it as well. So let's close our time in prayer tonight. Father, we're thankful for your word. And Lord, it's our prayer that you have placed us here for a reason. And Lord, not just as individuals, but as a body. And Lord, we want to, and it's our prayer, that we pass on your word, your truth, effectively, not only to the generation behind us, but also to those that are within our family, to those that we work with, Lord, to those we come in contact with, and those who we teach and so forth. Lord, so help us as we just begin to digest what you have, Lord, and help us to grow in you as well. Give us a great day tomorrow and bring us back again Friday evening just for a great time around your table. Be with those who are gone for spring break. Bring them back safely, we pray. We pray for a special anointing of your Holy Spirit this Sunday morning. Lord, as we anticipate just a full house, Lord, as we are effectively minister your word through worship and song, and Lord, use us as a body to minister to each other. In Christ's name we pray, amen. Lord, bless you, and have a great evening.